Hello, I'm Barbara Brailsford. We have just completed 20 years of hospice services in the community, and it seemed appropriate that we reflect back and share some of the history. Somehow I agreed to help put this video together, and now I find myself presenting it to you. It has not only been interesting but fun researching the scrapbooks and the album. I hope this effort will convey to you an appreciation to those who have been dedicated to this special organization. I have asked Jean Moore to help me with the early history of Volunteers for Hospice, as she was in on it from the very beginning. Jean, you are a member of Faith Presbyterian Church, where many of our founders attended and formed a nucleus for what has become a very important organization in this community. Can you tell us how it came about that they were interested in organizing?
Actually, I saw a report on TV about a hospice in England. I thought for some time about it and felt Sun City had a great need for one. As I was on the mission committee at Faith Church, I brought it out there, and Dr. Illingworth said, "Do it. We asked the other churches to join with us, and soon had 30 plus who wanted to take the training." About then, we heard of Sister Teresa, who had worked in Tucson at an organized hospice.
The meeting to explore the feasibility of providing hospice care for the terminally ill in the Sun City area was held in March of 1979. Gordon Anderson, who served as chairman of an ad hoc committee, arranged for the meeting. Dr. Milton Fox was the chairman. As a physician on active duty at Luke Air Force Base, he had patients from the area and was interested in their care. Representatives from Boswell Hospital, the Good Shepherd Retirement Center, Luke, and other health service facilities attended. Since the hospice concept involves the spiritual, social, and psychological care, they realized that many volunteers would be needed. The next step was a meeting where Hospice of the Valley brought leaders to speak. Sister Teresa McIntyre, who was now working with this group, told of her recent experiences as administrator at Hillhaven Hospice in Tucson. They advised that the planning and obtaining of necessary license and permits takes 2 to 3 years. However, they offered the group the opportunity to join them. By using their umbrella, the group could be ready to serve the Sun City area before the end of the year. So the ad hoc committee was dissolved and joined with a broader-based ecumenical group to be known as the Steering Committee. Dr. Fox became the temporary chairman. Grace Grunick, who had been a freelance writer and public speaker in New York, along with her husband Ted, were interested in the concept, and Grace was asked to write articles about hospice for the newspaper. Speeches were given at service clubs and churches to gather interest. Sister Teresa agreed to help with training, and the first class began in September, graduating 26 volunteers in November of that year. Jean, my notes tell me that the next month, an organizational meeting was held and officers were elected for the Sun City branch of Hospice of the Valley. It was at this time they established bylaws and Boswell Hospital offered them office space in their Annex B. When were you asked to be the coordinator for the volunteers?
I really haven't a clear idea when I was asked to do that, but it was early on in the organization, because when I went into the office, it was just an office.
How did you manage to furnish and staff an office?
Well, first day I was in the hospital in a little room they weren't using, and they decided to give it to us. I was sitting on the only chair when a woman came to the door and said, "Is this hospice?" And I said, "I hope it will be." She came in, introduced herself, Eleanor Leonard, and said that she would be willing to help. I blush when I think of what I said to her. I said, "Do you know how to do this, to be a good secretary?" She said, "Oh, I think so." I later learned that she had been secretary to the president of General Motors. I had a red face for a long time.
By the end of the first year, 75 volunteers had been trained and 42 patients had been cared for, which certainly proved that there was a need for this service. Sister Teresa also gave a seminar for doctors, nurses, clergy, and social workers in an attempt to educate the professional people that would be needed to further the organization. By the spring of 1984, it became evident to the Sun City Hospice Committee that they could survive independently and continue to serve the community. Roseanne Rowe was hired as coordinator. Did you continue to work in hospice after Roseanne came?
To tell you the truth, I think I'm still working in hospice. I find that I'm called by patients, by their family, by their few physicians, and their religious leaders. And I always ask to have one of the young workers with me, but I still work with them.
That's wonderful. 2 years later, Bill Foster was asked to be the executive director. Both were part-time positions, the volunteer coordinator and the executive director. But it made it possible not only to train more volunteers, but to become better known in the community and thus increase fundraising. In the fall of 1989, Roseanne left and Lou Carey was hired. It was through her efforts that Hospice Services of the Sun Cities area, as it became known, successfully met the standards for certification by the state of Arizona and obtained a license. They chose, however, not to seek approval for Medicare reimbursement, but remained strictly a volunteer entity. A doctor on the executive board was available should the patient's own doctor not continue, and nursing could be obtained through the home health agencies. A registered nurse served as volunteer coordinator. 1990 was an eventful year with changes reflecting the growth of hospice volunteer services. Elizabeth Stahl was hired as part-time coordinator, and Peggy Griffith became executive director later that year. This relieved Joy Beanlin, who had served as a volunteer coordinator until Elizabeth was hired, and as executive director after Bill Foster's retirement. The same year found us moving into the Sun Health Services building, which afforded us three large offices and available meeting room space when it was needed. The name was changed again, this time as Hospice Volunteer Services of the Sun Cities area. to make our designation more clear to those calling for our services. A computer was purchased, and our faithful office manager, Irma Johnson, retired. She was soon to celebrate her 82nd birthday and decided she wanted to travel instead of learning to use a computer. She looked forward to her first trip to Europe soon after she retired. Fundraising became a big project for Peggy. Mailings went out more often, and projects were organized. Hot dog sales at a rec center fair was fun and brought in a small amount. Note paper was designed by a volunteer, and others helped to paint them. Volunteers set up tables at shopping centers and sold amaryllis bulbs as well as the note paper. All of these helped to pay for more training classes. The big bunny maker of the day, however, was when Gladys Miller brought her idea of a loving Christmas tree with lovely handmade ornaments which could be purchased in memory of loved ones. Another mailer went out, and advertising was done to make it known to the community. The response was heartwarming as people took to the thought and cherished the ornaments which they could keep as a remembrance of their loved ones. Dorothy Cobby has assisted Gladys in this project. Volunteers crocheted the ornaments, and the number and size of the trees has grown each year. Our first official hospice angel appeared to us in the form of Morris Heidewitt, who asked to help with mailers. Stacks of boxes of envelopes were taken to him to have address labels affixed. As he put the labels on, we discovered he was checking the zip codes and made certain that we were not paying for wrong addresses to be mailed. Not an easy task for 30,000 to 40,000 envelopes. The speed and accuracy with which he worked amazed us all. We gathered more angels who agreed to crochet jackets for ornaments. The willingness of members of the community to give enthusiastic support has been the lifeblood of the organization and continues to be. Dan Levinsky became a member of the board and served as president. He had the foresight to appoint a planning committee, which has served to look ahead and address the needs both now and for the future. Wonderful things happen with hospice. For example, Lorena Winkleman listened to her patient when he expressed the desire to return to his native Sweden, which he had left 65 years ago. His only remaining family were there, and he wished that he might die in his native land. Lorena talked to the case manager, and the hospice team determined that it could be done. His niece was contacted, and by transferring to a New York hospice who met him at the airport with a nurse and all the equipment that he might need during the time until his plane left for Sweden. A Swedish hospice met him and saw him safely to a care center where his family were all able to visit and where he enjoyed 2 months of life at home. Late in 1997, hospice volunteers moved again into a new office where it now resides. Our expanded fundraising had allowed us to become independent of Sun Health's generous support. The name has been changed again to Volunteers for Hospice, and a new logo adopted to gain a better image to the community and make them aware of our expanding scope. Board members were inspired by the changes taking place in hospice worldwide and felt the need for more time than was available at regular board meetings to make plans for the future. President Bill Proctor thought it appropriate to hold a full-day retreat. Board members willingly gave more time for a concentrated workshop. This has given even more enthusiasm to the board to look forward to new ways to give service to the communities that we serve. The 20th anniversary in 1999 has been a time for reflection as well as looking forward. We had lost our beloved volunteer and board member, Bill Flynn. A memorial fund was established from donations made in his name, and the first Bill Flynn Scholarship Award was given to a deserving photography student to honor Bill's love of Kodak memory. Also, the first Bill Flynn Humanitarian Award was given to Sally McLaren for her untiring efforts in caring for patients and her service on the board of directors. Elva Flynn was present and deeply touched by the memorial to her husband. All who attended the appreciation luncheon must agree that it was a truly festive luncheon and showed the great thoughtfulness by our officers. Approximately half of the 15 board members are professional people who lend their time and expertise to guide us in the right direction. They are volunteers who deserve recognition as well as we who care for patients. It takes lots of teamwork to grow as we have and to continue in the future.